Welcome back to KC Talks EV. And yes, it's finally time to do the 40,000 mile update video on my Mark 1 MGZS EV. So first of all, I do want to apologise for missing the 30,000 mile update video. Essentially, I think in October, November time, I did have a couple projects going on anyway for the YouTube channel. And then on top of that, I did have some work stuff that needed to be sorted. So I do apologise for missing that out. Now, in this video, we are going to talk about the costs associated between the 20 and 30,000 mile mark, as well as servicing. So don't worry about that. It will be coming in this video. So as I mentioned, this video will be split into six distinct sections. So first of all, we're going to talk about total cost. The next thing we're going to talk about is servicing and the costs associated with that. Then we're going to talk about issues with the car. And yes, I have had a couple issues, which we're going to talk about in this video. Tyre tread depths. And then an additional section, which one of my viewers pointed out wasn't in the previous one, and I definitely probably should mention, is state of health or SOH on the battery, as well as balancing data. And then finally, any future plans. So anyway, without further ado, let's get started. So in this section, we're going to be talking about total cost, or essentially how much has it actually cost me to run my ZS EV for 20,000 miles. So I do have my notes here just to make sure I don't forget anything, but essentially in total, it has cost me £479 to run my car 20,000 miles. Now, if you then split it between the 20 and 30,000 mile segment, what we find is that that actually cost me £250 in total, or the equivalent of 2.5 pence per mile. And then if you look at the 30 to 40,000 mile mark, we're looking at £220 or 2.2 pence per mile. Now, if you then compare it to the 20,000 mile update video, the 10,000 to 20,000 mile segment cost me £141.75. So it is quite a significant increase. So, I mean, if you have a look at that, it's nearly, what, 60% increase or two thirds. So I guess in a way, why has it actually gone up? Now, there are two reasons why that is the case. First of all, you have to look at home charging. Now, my home charging is actually on a tariff called Octopus Go Faster. It's the 5-hour one. So previously, I was paying 5.5 pence per kilowatt hour, and now I'm paying 8.25 pence per kilowatt hour. Now, that is a significant increase on relative terms, I guess. Now, in absolute terms, essentially, it's instead of costing me around £2.50 to charge my car, it's now closer to £3.50, £4. So realistically, it hasn't actually gone up that much, but it is still a cost increase to bear. The second area is rapid charging. And if you have a look at the table down here, as we can see, all of the charge operators have actually increased their prices for rapid charging at some point between January 2022 and July 2022, as we are filming this video. What we find is that some of them have increased it very slightly. So in the case of Pod Points, that's around 7%. In the case of things like Genie Point, BP Pulse and things, they've gone up 20%, maybe 35%, I think was the most expensive one or increase. So yes, in a way, these rapid charging operators have increased their prices quite a bit. Now, one thing I do want to note is that although my relative costs in terms of percentage increase has gone up by quite a bit, in terms of absolute terms, I mean, going from 1.4 pence per mile to 2.5 pence per mile isn't really that much. I mean, you do have to keep in mind that while my costs have also increased, the petrol and diesel price has also increased as well. So if you have a look at the average petrol price at the moment, it has gone down a little bit since sort of recording this, but essentially it's gone to around £1.90 a litre for petrol. If you have a comparison to my previous car, which was a Hyundai i20, it did on average 48 miles to the gallon. You were paying around 18 pence per mile. So therefore, even at the more expensive rate at 2.5 pence per mile, you're still saving 15.5p for every mile you cover. And if I'm honest, I'm quite happy with that even still. So overall, it is still a massive cost saving compared to my old petrol car. So in terms of servicing, yes, this car was serviced again at the 30,000 mile 2-year mark. Just to reiterate and recap, the Mark 1 MGZS EV has service intervals of 15,000 miles or 1 year, whichever is sooner. So as I mentioned on the previous video, I was originally going to take it to a mobile EV servicing place. Unfortunately, just due to timings and just ease, I just took it straight back to the main dealer. So Maple Garage, they're really, really good to me anyway. And if I'm honest, I would highly recommend them to do this sort of thing. Plus, by taking it back to a main dealer, I also got my AA recovery renewed for another year. And I also got a Morris the Teddy Bear. It was a little bit expensive, don't get me wrong. It was £222. But Maple Garage always do a good job, so I don't really mind. So, have I had any issues with my Mark 1 ZS EV? And unfortunately, after 40,000 miles, I will have to tell you that yes, I have. So first of all, the charging flap has broken. What I probably should mention is the actual charging itself is fine and the actual mechanism to lift it and close it is fine. Unfortunately, though, the pulsating light has stopped working. Now, this actually stopped around the 25,000 mile mark. When I picked up the MG5 long range for testing, as far as I'm aware, I actually asked them to have a look at it, and they did, and they repaired it. Unfortunately, after that, this was just after the 30,000 mile service, so essentially, it's a bit annoying really, it broke again. So originally what happened was the wires, which I believe are these ones, are just very, very thin, meaning that they are prone to breaking. They just resoldered it, it started working again. But then unfortunately, I think the wires must have just broken again. So does it really matter for me, at least? Probably not. So the reason why is that I currently use the Open Vehicle Monitoring System box, or OVMS, in order to get things like state of charge and whether or not it's charging through my phone. So essentially, it doesn't really matter. I can get that data without having a pulsating light. In fact, actually, the light doesn't even tell me state of charge, so the OVMS is better. Not to mention that when I do publicly charge, for example, I do find it very annoying when, for example, it's got a pulsating light. I don't really want people to know I'm charging. So in a way, having no light there is probably beneficial. I do want to say that it is a bit of a shame that it did break. The fact is, MG knew that this part wasn't exactly a particularly strong component of the car. The reason why they knew was, if you have a look at the limited warranty exclusion terms, what you find is that they only offered a year warranty on the whole sort of charging flap mechanism, which is really, really annoying, really. They knew about it, they knew it was prone to breaking, so they offered less warranty in comparison to the rest of the car. So, is it a problem? No, but at some point in time, I would like to get it fixed and potentially a more permanent fix. So the other problem is, and this is very light in the grand scheme of things, so essentially the panoramic sunroof, when you've got it in the tilted position, especially when you're driving, it actually creaks now. I expect that when it gets serviced again, so this is a 40,000 mile update video, so essentially when it gets to its 45,000 mile and for its third service, they'll probably just get a bit of grease on that and sort it out. So the final issue is that the false boot floor has actually fractured, or essentially broke in half. I'll show you some footage of it here. What's happened, I believe, is I put something very heavy, I believe it was my electric bike, I think, in the boot, and essentially I've just broken it in half. It's probably not the strongest thing on earth anyway, and in order to do this, you do have to have it in the topmost position. But because there isn't anything supporting it apart from the edges and the sides, effectively it is more prone to fracturing. Now, I think in a way it's definitely not a warranty job, so that's a bit unfortunate. But when I come around to, for example, repairing it myself, I'll probably get some wood just to strengthen it underneath it. Alternatively, I could actually buy a break-in MGZS internal combustion engine or ICE car. I believe they have the same false boot floors, and essentially just take one of those and then just put it in my one. It's not really that much of a big deal for me. I do now keep my boot in the lowest position most of the time, so it's not too much of an issue. But I think when I come to, for example, sell the car or something, I will probably get a brand new false floor. Now, this bit isn't actually a issue as such, but this car has actually been recalled. So I originally believed that this car didn't have this problem. If you have a look on the MG forums, there was actually a door loom which needed to be recalled. I believed it wasn't this particular age of car. I believed it was one of the first ever models. This car was actually delivered to me in December 2019. So I was kind of hoping that it wasn't part of that, but in the end, it turns out I needed a full recall for it. They replaced, I believe, the wiring loom behind the driver's door, I think. I'm not quite sure what the major issue was, but they did it free of charge, gave me a courtesy car. It was done with Maple Garage, and they even cleaned and vacuumed the car, which was quite nice of them. So, yeah, not particularly an issue. There wasn't any major changes to the actual car after getting it back, but still, just for a peace of mind and just to let you know, yes, this car has had the recalled door loom. So in this portion of the video, I am going to have to apologise quickly. If you have a look at the 20,000 mile update video, what I said was my tyre treads were around 5mm all round. Now, unfortunately, I don't think that was actually the case. If you go to the 30,000 mile service booklet that they gave you, the tyre treads were around 5mm. And given the fact that they're now at 40,000 miles, I would have expected by now I would definitely need a replacement. However, at the moment, they're currently on 2.5mm, 3mm on the front, and around 4.5mm, 5mm on the rears. What this means, basically, is that I believe I probably got it a little bit wrong, and now I am definitely looking for a replacement. At the moment, it looks as though I'm going to be replacing them with Michelin Primacy 4 tyres, so when Costco do finally have an offer on again for those Michelin tyres, I'll probably replace them then. So this segment was actually suggested by one of my viewers, and it was battery state of health. Now, I haven't actually mentioned it on the previous update, so on the 10,000 mile update or the 20,000 mile update video, but now since I have OVMS all set up, I can actually show you how that works. So as I mentioned, I do use OVMS. It gives you state of charge, as well as it actually gives you state of health. If you go into the vehicle info section, you can actually load that up. So currently at 41,000 miles as of filming, I have done quite a bit since the 40,000 mile part, it's actually at 92% state of health. This means that it has lost some level of capacity, so it's lost around 8%, although with the current journeys that I am doing, it hasn't really affected it that much, no major issues for example. I've also got the balancing data here. I'll put it in the description below as well, just to, if you do want to look at the information in more detail. What we find is that there was approximately 12 millivolt difference between the worst performing cell and the best performing cell. That's actually really good when it comes to balancing. What I probably should mention is that because of the Octopus Go Faster tariff I am on, you don't actually get enough time to fully balance the pack overnight, which is really, really annoying. But interestingly, it has seemed to keep actually the balancing of all the cells quite regular, which is really, really good. By the way, if you do want me to actually do a video on how to set up OVMS and also a small mod that I've done so I get free data for it, just let me know in the comments. So there is one long distance journey that I will be covering, and that is actually my regular journey back down to Yeovil in Somerset from Hull. So in terms of long distance journeys, I can finally do the video which I have probably mentioned across my 43 videos that I have done, and that is that long distance journey from Hull down to Yeovil. Now, I have now done this multiple times since the COVID restrictions have been lifting, then come back on again and so on. But essentially, I've never actually fully documented it, so I will be doing that. Now, I'm only going to be doing the leg from Hull to Yeovil, and the reason why is because I'm really excited to tell you that I will be attending the British Motor Show this year. So what I'm hoping to do this year is just sort of document what the brand new EVs there are on the market showcased there at the British Motor Show. So I'm really, really excited for that. Let me know in the comments what you would actually want me to document. So in terms of sort of charging and things like that, so I was hoping to get one of those Give Energy EV chargers. The main reason why and the main driver for this was I was originally going to get a Zappy until literally Give Energy released their EV charger, which works perfectly well with my Give Energy hybrid inverter and battery. So essentially, I was hoping to get one installed before the start of summer, just so I could maybe use a lot of that excess solar energy that I'm currently exporting. Unfortunately though, I've contacted Give Energy and they've recently told me that they are not planning on actually making them available until September. The reason behind it is they really want to get the UK manufacturing base up and running fully before they start selling them to customers. So it is a little bit unfortunate that that is not going to happen, but I really can't wait for it to be released, and hopefully, fingers crossed, I will have one and I will sort of do a review on it. So make sure that you are subscribed and make sure you hit that bell icon to make sure that you are notified of that. So that's pretty much it for the 40,000 mile update video. So if you like this video or you found it informative, please give it a like. Dislike it if you didn't. Please share this video to anyone with a MG electric car. I think it would be interesting for them to see what their car will be like in the coming years. And to be fair, I'm hoping to take this car up to 100,000 miles, and we'll wait and see to see whether that will be the case. So make sure that you are subscribed and you click on that bell icon so you are notified of that. But I think that is pretty much it. So thank you for watching, and talk to you later.